Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to our first midweek Lenten worship, shared worship between our congregation and St. Paul's UCC. Good to see you tonight. We'll be gathering like this with soup and bread meal prior to worship all five Wednesday evenings. Next week, we will be at St. Paul's UCC over on White Oak Street. Don't panic. Everything will be on these monitors, okay? So that's why you don't have bulletins. We should get by okay with that. The only exception will be in the prayers, which tend to get a bit lengthy. There will be dot, dot, dots. You'll see the beginning and the end, and then when there's something for you to do, it will show that. You will have all of the words for the hymns up on the monitors as well. The gospel reading will be up on the monitor. Pretty much everything else in our service of worship this evening. We won't ask you to have anything memorized, other than the music, which you'll get to learn a little bit. All right, in that regard, Brandon, can you bring up that slide? He won't go through them this fast, I will promise you that. There we go. When this first appears, as you see, and I have a monitor behind you, so I'm pointing to it, you'll see this hymn that we are to sing. When this appears, we're not asking you to sing. This will be our fourth singer, Bruce Rohrbach, an organist tonight. He will sing it through, and then Brandon will scroll the slide. Oh, it's only on once? Ah, there we go. And then we'll sing it when it's on like that, okay? And we will sing it in subsequent times when that comes up on the screen. But the first time, Bruce will sing it for us so we get a sense of the flow of the music. Oh, it is, okay. Well, then you'll just need to leave it up there because it's in the bulletin twice. Okay. That was all my explanation for tonight. There is another hymn, but I think you'll know that one, or the tune's familiar, you've heard it around. You Raise Me Up, and we'll be singing that this evening as well. Okay, let us join together in worship this evening. Lent is often known as a time of giving something up in order to make room in our lives for spiritual pursuits. Rather than just giving up in Lent, the scriptures ask us to consider all that Jesus is up to, and all that he asked us to be up to in his name. Instead of bemoaning what we can't do or used to do in a culture where measuring up to external standards seems impossible, this Lent, we will celebrate the small things that we can do right now to respond to God's call in our place for our time. The first week of this series brings us to the moment at which Jesus comes up out of the waters of baptism to hear, "You are my beloved." We are called to come up out of the depths of whatever seeks to keep us under and know that we are beloved of God. Come up, for now is the time to be fully who you are created to be for the sake of the world.
When I am down, and oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come, and my heart burden me, then I am
Let us pray together. Loving God, we come before you needing to feel lighter. We are weighed down with expectations and difficult news. Sometimes it is our own doing that weighs us down. In this moment of quiet, we lift up to you those things we'd like to give up for good, for the sake of the good. Hear assurance in what the psalmist proclaims. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Do not let me be put to shame. Do not let my enemies exult over me. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth. And teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you I will wait all day long. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love. For they have been from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me for your goodness' sake. O Lord, good and upright is the Lord. In the name of Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be.
As people forgiven and freed, we reach out to lift others up, offering the peace of Christ. And now the peace of Christ be with you. I invite you to share that peace with others as you are comfortable doing this night.
Let us join together in our hymn, O Lord, throughout these 40 days.
So I'm going to confess that I picked the wrong gospel. So, Brandon, you don't have to put the words to the gospel up there because it's not going to match. So, here, let me. So, I'm going to read it to you. I am going to ask, can you see this item that's up on the altar? Can you all see it in the back? Okay, I'm going to just hold it up.
Do you want me to be your Vanna and stand over there?
Vanna, if you would like to, okay. You could do that. So what we're reading is Mark chapter 8, verses 31 through 38. Thank you, Vanna. Then Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, Jesus rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any wish to come after me, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes into the glory of his Father with the holy angels." Sorry, I have to open this back up. This is the word of the Lord. Oh, the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you for your flexibility. So this evening's gospel lesson begins with, "Then he began to teach them." And it's often helpful to know what happened before then. So just prior to verse 31, the gospel tells us Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and still others one of the prophets." And then Jesus asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter answered, "You are the Messiah." And then Jesus sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. There are times in the gospel in which the disciples are portrayed as, I almost hate to say it, kind of clueless. Like the demons know who Jesus is and they call out to him as Messiah. People of other faiths, even those who worship idols, know who Jesus is. However, those closest to Jesus, the disciples, didn't seem to understand. Jesus quizzes his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, Elijah, one of the prophets." But they still don't get it, do they? If this were a game show, we'd hear, Then Jesus asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter answers him, "You are the Messiah." And if this were a game show, ding, 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 ding. Oh my goodness, at last, one of the disciples finally gets it. And Peter saying, "You are the Messiah," scholars call that the Petrin Confession. And that confession is not admitting to a crime or a misdemeanor, but it's a confession of belief and understanding of who Jesus is, and at last, someone gets it. Following this amazing moment of clarity, the scripture then tells us that Jesus sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. So one moment you put two and two together and you get Messiah and you're a genius, and then the next moment you're sternly sworn to secrecy over this discovery. Kind of odd. This brings us into our gospel lesson. And keep the sworn to secrecy part in your mind. So then Jesus started teaching that he, the Son of Man, would suffer, be rejected by religious officials, be killed, and after 3 days of being dead, he'll rise again. Jesus said all of this quite openly. But didn't he just tell us we couldn't talk about this? So what is it we're not supposed to talk about? Is it the Son of Man thing? That's a term not only used to refer to Jesus as a human, as well as the Messiah, but it was also used in other cultures, such as the Romans, to mean that their kings or their emperors were divine too. It's kind of confusing, isn't it? So Peter takes Jesus aside and rebukes him. And we don't really know what Peter said. But I think an educated guess might be, Jesus, didn't you just say that we can't talk about this? It sounds terrible and dangerous. And then Jesus rebukes Peter in very harsh terms. Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. Oh, so Peter isn't seeing things the way that God sees things. As a human being, Peter is considering what Jesus said and wonders why the Messiah isn't strong and mighty. As a human being, Peter doesn't understand why Jesus needs to suffer, be rejected by religious leaders, and killed. And I think we can kind of empathize with Peter's view. Have you ever seen the movie The Titanic? Mm-hmm. Right? You've seen that movie. It's sort of like watching that movie and hoping the whole time that the Titanic will not strike an iceberg, and hoping if it does hit the iceberg, something's going to happen and the ship's not going to go down. But no matter what we wish is going to happen, that ship is going to sink. And every year during Holy Week, and even leading up to it, we keep wishing something else would happen, and Jesus would not be arrested, about betrayed, arrested, beaten, suffer, and die. And yet, each year, we relive this journey with Jesus. Jesus then called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If anyone wishes to come after me, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." So does this mean that every disciple could expect to suffer and die? It is believed that about 25% of them were martyred. So not every single disciple suffered, maybe suffered, but certainly didn't all die. They weren't martyred. But it was a real fear. For most of us as Christians, we don't have to worry about suffering and death because we're Christians. But there are parts of the world, Afghanistan as an example, North Korea, Coptic Christians in Egypt, among others, in which suffering and death is a real concern today. So what does it mean to take up your cross? Earlier this week, a friend gave me that beautiful ceramic piece of art that Vanna held up for you to see better. Clearly, Jesus is struggling with that cross. But what we can't see is that Simon of Cyrene helped Jesus carry it the rest of the way. I think of taking up the cross as something akin to a relay race. One runner's running, and then the next runner, I guess I should hold it back, right? I guess they grab that baton and they run forward. And that keeps going during the whole race. Taking up the cross sounds like a very daunting task. But when we take up the cross, the weightiness of that cross is distributed across disciples like those runners in the relay race. When we take up the cross, we have to set aside a lot of things, like the disciples did. They dropped their nets, they set aside their lives, and they got behind Jesus, and they took up the cross. Taking up the cross involves living the life that Jesus has shown us by his example we are supposed to live. We're supposed to live lives of humility, compassion, service, and forgiveness. Take up the cross, friends. Take up the cross. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen. Lent is traditionally a time when the church focuses on spiritual practices that can take many forms. Various ways of praying, meditating, journaling. Let us sing Psalm 144 as our prayer song. This first week, we'll listen to our choir sing it once, and then we'll repeat the refrain. Well, we don't have a choir, but we have Bruce in a moment or two. I think there's more to go. Oh, no, we skipped some. All right.
Let my prayer rise up like incense. The lifting up of my hands as an offering to you. My prayer rise up like incense before you. The lifting up of my hands as an offering to you.
We call upon you, O God, in the midst of all the contours of our lives. We thank you for those who continue to work the work of seeking justice for those oppressed because of their race, ethnic origin, or sexual orientation.
Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you.
We call upon you, O God, to incline your ear and extend your love and healing power for these laments. We ask for your healing presence and power to change hearts in the face of the continuing gun violence throughout our nation. We ask for your strength for the people of Ukraine in the face of the aggression of Vladimir Putin and Russia. And we pray for the Palestinian people in Gaza and the Israelites who mourn the death of loved ones or those held hostage. We pray that the leaders of the Palestinians and of Israel might find a way forward in peace.
Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you.
We call upon you, O God, to give us the strength and courage to be up to something good for the sake of the good. In this moment, in our mind's eye, we imagine and offer our commitment to one small thing this week that will lift someone up, elevate and affirm the good when we see it, and bring a bit more calm or joy where we are. And if we find we are not up to it, we pray we can accept the goodness of others and feel your encouraging love. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you.
And so now, go into the world, knowing that as a disciple of Jesus, as a beloved child of the Holy One, and an heir of the Holy Spirit, with angels attending you, you have all you need to be up to something. When someone asks you, "What are you up to?" you can respond, "With God's help, I'm up to something good." Let the people say, "Amen."